Hello, Sean. Very good morning. Let's start with probably the last lecture for the semester. I will start it with continuing the presentation of what I had put up last time. Just give me a couple of moments. Fine. So we have been speaking about this, and we spoke in detail about primary and secondary activities as such. We were left with the service sector, which tends to be divided into, I would say, tertiary, quaternary, and quinary activities. I'll enlarge it. Tertiary, quaternary. Now, this is from NCERT's textbook. I have already posted reference to these in our, I've put this up in my Google Drive, and I have posted the links of this in our group. So there should not be any issue as far as understanding this is concerned. And reference to this is always available. Tertiary activities include trade and commerce. On one side, we spoke the other day, transport, communication, and then further divided into services. Okay. When we speak about trade and commerce, it includes wholesale trade and retail trade. And wholesale would include urban supplies and rural supplies also. Okay, you'll see that as far as retailing is concerned, in rural areas you have periodic markets, basically because there is not that much of business due to the population size, and as a consequence they have these periodic markets, say weekly markets as such. But urban areas, you'll see that the population being larger, there's a large scope, and as a consequence you'll see that you'll have chain stores, shopping centers, public distribution systems, and of course home delivery or mail orders as such, through telephones and internet as such. We know that nowadays, in fact, a lot of food delivery is taking place through this. A lot of commodity delivery is taking through this particular place. Transport includes road transport, railway transport, that will be land transport as such, and then water, which is going to be inland and international. That is further divided into cargo services and passenger services. Cargo services involve a huge amount of transportation, and that too as far as containerization is concerned. The same thing goes with the air also. You'll see that you have passenger traffic and you have cargo traffic. Okay, that's about the transport as such. As far as communication is concerned, you'll see that this would include telephones, landlines, and mobiles as such. And then you communicate. That's basically advertisements tend to get through films, radio, television, print media, that's newspapers and magazines as such. The services involve financial banking, insurance, real estate, personal and professional services, in the sense private, government and NGOs as such. Then quaternary activities is information based, R&D based. As I said, you need to be qualified to be that particular individual providing that particular service as far as quaternary activities is concerned. And I would say quinary activities is basically an outfall of quaternary, but because the scale at which this is happening. Okay, say for example, a doctor is attending what, a maximum of 500 patients. A teacher is teaching maximum of around 1000 students maximum. Okay, but the volume increases, the number increases significantly when we move to quinary activities, and these decisions, okay, the decision makers, the specialists, and consultants and policy makers, formulators here actually are impacting thousands of people, I would rather say tens of thousands of people. And that is why you will see that multinationals, people heading multinationals, people heading governments, etc., could be classified under quinary activities as such. Okay, that's as far as the distribution of the service sector is concerned. Now, let us move ahead, and I would say I would require a blank slide. I don't know whether I've placed it here. Let me see if I have a blank slide available with me. Otherwise, I'll have to create one for ourselves. Let me see. We should be having one, I suppose. Just give me a couple of moments. If not, we will have to create one slide for ourselves. Because now I'm moving ahead to the two major activities that we are supposed to be discussing here. We have the blank slide as such. These two activities, as per your syllabus, happen to be agriculture and industry. Comparison. Now, these two, you would say, why have we selected these two? If you remember, when we were doing population, there have been two major revolutions as far as human civilization is concerned. These developments have been the agricultural revolution, okay, which took place about 10,000 years ago, okay, when man moved into sedentary agriculture. And then say four or five centuries ago, we have the industrial revolution as such. Okay, I will not be going into the details of various aspects of agriculture, basically because you'll see that we have a separate paper on agricultural geography at PG level. So one could go on and on as far as speaking on agriculture is concerned. India particularly is an agriculture-based country. So again, if one starts to speak about agriculture in India, it would be some time before which one would finish speaking on it. And that's why what I've decided is to give you a very broad idea about agriculture, various terminologies nowadays which are being used in agriculture, and how agriculture has developed over the last 10,000 years as such. We'll see that the first word that we would be associating with agriculture is going to be when man went into what is called as sedentary agriculture. He settled down along the banks of major river plains as such, and he started getting selective. Selective about the crops as such. Okay, but the various I would say agricultural types that man has been through, I would say that before man went into for sedentary agriculture, he was actually practicing what you could say is shifting agriculture. Now, a very interesting part about agriculture is that this is one of the oldest forms of agriculture practiced by man, but you'll see that even today you find some sections of the population in some underdeveloped parts of the world continuing with shifting agriculture. They are named differently in different parts of the world. You'll see that in Indonesia, India, that's particularly northeastern parts of India, you have various tribes practicing shifting agriculture. It's also called as slash and burn. What these people do is they clear off certain areas, and having cleared them, they practice agriculture. Now, because they are not, I would say, it's the agriculture is more nature-based, and you'll see that the fertility is lost in 3, 4, 5 cycles, and after 5 cycles of agricultural production, these people move to new areas, and that's why the word shifting comes in as such. Okay, then the next type of agriculture is basically subsistence agriculture. Subsistence, you'll see that India is known for subsistence agriculture. Subsistence agriculture basically means growing crops for your personal needs as such. You're not growing it for commercial purposes as such. Okay. Now, areas having high densities of population, areas having small sizes of farms will have a lesser produce, obviously, and that produce is going to be used up within the family, which is larger in size. As a consequence, such types of agriculture, okay, in fact, you'll see that it is called as intensive subsistence. We have done the characteristics of this in our school days as such. Intensive subsistence agriculture, and opposite to this, you have extensive mechanized agriculture. I would say Australia and Canada would be the best examples of extensive mechanized agriculture as such. Now here, the farm sizes are so huge, so huge, so huge that it cannot be labor intensive. And as a consequence, a lot of machines are employed in these, and that's why these have to be mechanized also as such. Now, I would say that in areas with high density of population, say like France, for example, and England also, you could say, you have intensive mechanized. Okay, intensive mechanized, wherein in small areas, they employ very advanced machines to cultivate crops also as such. Then I would say there are a few more types of agriculture which you may have done. And one of them is plantation agriculture. And this is a very peculiar type of agriculture which came up with colonization. When the Europeans moved into the tropical regions and colonized many tropical areas as such, they were interested in planting tropical crops and taking the products away into to Europe as such. So from fruits like banana, pineapples, to beverage crops like tea and coffee, to spices and others like tobacco, rubber, commercial products also as such. Okay, you'll see that hundreds and hundreds of hectares of land was cleared, and plantation agriculture was taken up. Palm trees also, plantation of palm trees also comes under this as such. You'll see that all the plantations, particularly tea and coffee, that have been done in northeastern parts of India are thanks to this particular colonization of the British in India as such. Many such plantations are seen in Uti also, to some extent around Shimla also. So it's plantation agriculture, another type of agriculture that this planet has seen. Then you have something which is called as mixed farming. Now, as far as mixed farming is concerned, mixed, basically, you grow crops and you rear animals also. I would say cattle mostly, but then it could include other forms of animal. It could include poultry also. Now this, okay, where do you see people practicing mixed farming? You'll see that where you are not very sure about a regular crop harvest because of say unsurety of rain or insufficient rains, etc. You'll see that farmers tend to practice. Now this is more seen in developing and underdeveloped countries as such. It's seen in India as well, that particularly southern parts of India where the water supply is not going to be assured as such. Okay, or I would say where the agriculture is rain fed, you'll see that they'll rear cattle, they'll rear sheep, they'll rear poultry, as I've already said. So that's called as mixed farming as such. Okay. Then as urbanization grew, the demand for day-to-day products, not I'm not referring to cereals like wheat, rice, jowar, bajra, and etc. Day-to-day products like vegetable, fruits, flowers, etc. increased. And that brought up what is called as market gardening. Now, this is seen to have come from countries like, just a moment, market gardening comes to us from countries like Australia, particularly nowadays practiced in majority of the urban areas of the world. Now, what is market gardening? Oh, this is also called as truck farming. In Australia, it is called as truck farming. What is so characteristic about market gardening or truck farming as such? You'll see that the products are based on the demand from the market. That's why one reason they are called as market gardening. You'll see that huge trucks are used to transport these products, and that's why this is also called as truck farming as such. Okay, I've seen many students write an answer that farming taking place on trucks is called as truck farming. That's absolutely foolish to write about it. Now, if we are going to look at it as to how it evolved in Australia, I've already said that more than 90% of Australia lives in urban areas. So you could imagine the demand for such products in urban markets of Australia and the volume of which it is was going to be required. So the areas, agricultural areas around started practicing this, and they followed a very peculiar thing that you'll see that you'll have farms which are intensively mechanized, and they would have products like fruits, vegetables, etc. The plucking, etc. of the fruits, etc. takes place throughout the day. The packing of it starts around 5 o'clock in the evening. Sorting, packing, etc. all of this starts 5 o'clock in the evening. This carries on till night, around 9, 10 as such. Okay, and you'll see that around this time, trucks are going to arrive where all these boxes are packed as such. These boxes are then placed into the cabins of these trucks, the containers of these particular trucks as such. And by around 10:30, 11, wherein most of the other traffic silences down, they start moving towards the urban areas. They would have to cover 300 and 400 kilometers at during the night time. So we'll see that throughout the night, they would be driving, and it's early 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock that they would arrive in urban markets, and they would deposit these goods there, and they will start their journey back to their own respective farms after having deposited this as such. Because the trucks played, huge trucks played a major role in all this activity, this came to be also known as truck farming. Please remember, truck farming does not mean that trucks are used in farming or farming is done on trucks as such, nothing like that. Keep in mind, keep it in mind as such. Nowadays, you'll see that you have new forms of farming which are being practiced. One of that is called as vertical farming. Okay, you'll see that nutritious crops like mushrooms particularly, which are very rich in nitrogen content as such, proteins as such, are cultivated within the city. Okay, you'll see that within the city, they have these huge halls, and in those halls, they'll have this whole arrangement of cultivating mushrooms, etc. is concerned. And we will all know that mushroom was not that popular a food in India, particularly a couple of decades ago. But nowadays, of course, it has become a fashion thing, and you'll see that it's a highly prized delicacy which is placed in buffets, etc., in high marriages because of its nutritional value as such. There are other crops also which are cultivated in vertical farming as such. Then there is, in addition to this, I would say it's not an type of agriculture as such, but something which is being practiced of late. That's just erase this for us. This is called as agroforestry. okay, that cultivating forests are like agriculture. That means you are cultivating wood. That's called as agriculture, or rather agroforestry. And then you have what is called as agrotourism also. Okay, all of this is going to be classified under understanding agriculture as such. Okay. As far as factors affecting agriculture are concerned, we'll just list down these factors. We'll not go into the details of that. The factors affecting, okay, I would say physical or natural factors. You'll see that the relief is very important in this. Okay, you'll see that initially it was river plains which had very fertile silt, and as a consequence, majority of the civilizations grew up in the valleys of the Nile and the Indus and the Ganga, and of course the Wanghoo civilizations as such. But as population has grown, particularly in countries which have very high density population like Japan, China, you could say Indochina Peninsula, that's Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia. Here you'll see that even in India, as a matter of fact, rice cultivation, which is a popular crop in these areas, is cultivated in mountain slopes also. So relief plays an important role. Then of course climate, okay, given the diversity of crops that nature offers us, different climates support different types of crops. You'll see that rice is not grown in temperate regions and wheat is not grown in equatorial regions as such. So climate wise, okay, you have to decide which crop you are going to cultivate. And obviously another major factor on which agriculture is dependent on is soil as such. Then coming to the economic, you can read in details about this. I'm just giving you highlighting points of the factors, economic factors. First of it, of course, you need money as far as agriculture is concerned. Then with your products, you require transport for sure. Without market, all of this is not obviously going to be profitable. In many crops nowadays, storage facilities, warehousing is very, very important. With mass production taking place, large scale production taking place, and then of course export imports, exports and imports of various products as such. You'll see that India is a exporter of many agricultural products. Onions, for example, is something that is not grown everywhere, and India produces a lot of onion. In India, Maharashtra produces a lot of onion as such. So right from onions to mangoes also being exported as such, importing of products like wheat to some extent. Yes, we do require import of wheat as such. So all these are economic factors that need to be look into. Then you're going to have social factors. As far as social factors are concerned, we said that land holdings, the size of the land holding is very important. Okay, you'll see that as you pass from, as the land holdings pass from one level to the other, fragmentation takes place. And that has been one of the reasons why fragmentation takes place. That has been one of the reasons why the farm sizes in India has gone down. And recently there are talks of putting these together so that we could have a appreciable size of farm to be worked upon as such. Okay. Social also includes your openness to technology. Okay. When we say technology, it's use of irrigation wherever available, use of machines wherever available. I would further say use of fertilizers, use of insecticides and pesticides also. All of this comes under this comes under technology as such. Okay, so how a particular person is looking at technology as such. Nowadays, of course, a lot of fertilizers are used in the, unfortunately, these are chemical fertilizers, harming a lot of these things as such. One of the reasons why we require fertilizers, insecticides and pesticides is because we are nowadays practicing monoculture, that you are taking the same crop year after year, year after year, year after year. You'll see that the crops become less resistant, and as a consequence they are prone to these insect attacks, and that's why you need to use insecticides, pesticides, and then of course maintaining the health of the crop you require fertilizers. An option to this has been rotation of crops, and you must have studied this at an earlier class also, that you rotate these four crops as such, from cereal crops to legume crops and then back to cereal crops as the fourth choice once again in the fourth season. Rotation of crops is a natural way of maintaining the fertility. However, because monoculture is more common and easily practiced as such, not many farmers are interested in crop rotation, because a lot of cropping nowadays is market based rather than I would say something that would maintain the health of this as such. Okay. Now, last of these factors on which this is dependent on is government policies. Governments nowadays are playing a major role as far as agriculture, development of agriculture is concerned, from providing loans, I would rather say, okay, then providing subsidies is again something that governments provide. Nowadays, you'll see that agriculture or industry governments are playing a major role. And that's why you'll see that other factors, physical, economic, social, are taking significantly backseat. Okay? Then not only does this happen, you'll have the governments provide with a minimum support prices. Also, you'll see then that is what all this new agricultural policy is all about. Then the government provides what is called as assured markets also, that if a farmer is not able to sell his crops in open market, then the government not only gives him minimum support, they give him assured markets as such. You'll see that in Maharashtra you have cotton, which is bought under this. You have soybean, which is bought under this particular thing. And in fact, you have this complete setup in the sugar industry with regards sugar cane, which also would come under this particular category as such. So you'll see that in all possible things, of course, construction of canals, etc., is again something which comes under the government. So irrigation is heavily supported by the government, you could say. And something we have spoken earlier about, you'll see that you just can't go about exporting and importing. You need government permissions as far as exports and imports are concerned. From India, you'll see that fruits like cherries, and you have mangoes, and you have grapes, which are exported. You'll have spices. Spices have an assured market outside, so you'll see that they have a channelized thing. But something like, say, mangoes or particularly grapes, etc., see that there are many issues involved in this, and those who would be interested, could read in detail as to how European markets or American markets normally tend to play the play with the international prices, and how they dominate these things. Okay, you see that there have been fortunately, India is a diverse country, and we have multiple, and of course it's a large country also. There have been occasions wherein the smaller countries, particularly in South America and Africa, they are known for single crops as such. Okay, you'll see that some XYZ countries known for banana cultivation, some XYZ countries known for coconut cultivation, some XYZ countries known for coffee cultivation. Now you'll see that all of this cultivation is for export, and the smart guys in international markets, what they do is at the time of I would say harvesting, or I would say export, they will purposely make the prices of these products fall in international markets. That would doom the farmer in these respective countries. WTO is all about this, the World Trade Organization. They're trying to work out policies wherein there would be not much of fleecing and not much of destruction of the agricultural health of such countries as such. India also has been at the facing side as such. As far as other products are concerned, India is known to export sugar. India is known to export onions, okay, and of course many food crops is something which India does export. In relation to WTO, now you'll see that there are some products that countries, not only India, countries need to import, particularly because as an agreement under WTO, and that's why you'll see that in the last couple of decades, you have exotic fruits, particularly which are found in the markets as such. You'll see that these kiwi fruits, etc., which are not seen there in the Indian markets, because India is a diverse country and has its own share of fruits and vegetables as such. But you'll see that broccoli, of course, broccoli is nowadays cultivated in India also. Lettuce is something that arrived with after the WTO arrangement, and the Indian farmers, some Indian farmers was particularly those particularly involved in market gardening were smart enough to come up with producing these aspects also. So that is as far as agriculture is concerned. Before we close on agriculture, something which is very important is the environmental aspect of agriculture. You'll see that we keep hearing about this burning of stubble in Haryana and Punjab, and how it impacts the climate of the weather of Delhi, I would say, particularly in the winter season as such. Okay, and there is this huge political game going on between these states, I would say. That's one thing as such. Then you'll see that water supply, okay, you'll see that irrigation is something that is being supported by the government as such. And leave aside other states, if I would be speaking about Maharashtra as such, you'll see that western Maharashtra, that lies in the rain shadow region of the Sahyadris, right? So you'll see that districts like Pune, not whole of it, but significant, Solapur, and then other districts which are in the rain shadow region are actually taking crops like sugarcane, which are highly water intensive. So if you don't have rainwater, you're going to pull out water from underground groundwater, and you'll see that regular pulling out of water, draining out of water from groundwater resources is leading to risk fall in the groundwater levels, and this is impacting a lot of local environmental ecosystems also as such. Sustainability of agriculture is another thing. You'll see that start with some X crop, and over the period of time the requirements fall short, and then you either have to shift or the areas start getting to be barren as such. That's another thing about it. Use of fertilizers, use of pesticides, use of chemical fertilizers and pesticides is another major concern, basically because of a phenomena called as bioaccumulation. So that's also dangerous, and that's why another form of farming that is nowadays being practiced. We don't know how much this is going to be, this is true as such, but you must have heard about organic products and organic farming. As such, now you'll see that how I personally feel this is foolish is basically I could give you an example from Ayurveda. You'll see that I would not be naming those countries, but now companies, but you'll see that you have the medical markets or pharmaceutical shops being flooded with so-called Ayurvedic products or organic products as such. Now I was hearing to actually I was on a panel, and I was interviewing candidates who were supposed to be that was a mock interview, and I was supposed to be interviewing people who were supposed to be facing their final interviews at the MPSC, and there was this girl, very bright girl, from who had done her Ayurveda, and she was a doctor, and I asked her that how I purposely asked her as to how is it that you have this mass production of these Ayurvedic products by these people, and they flood the markets with their names. I'll purposely not name them, but we all know who we are speaking about. She said that, yes, it's very unfortunate, and getting the right results from these products is not possible, basically, because what we have learned in Ayurveda is that these products that we get from Ayurveda, which were used for treating various ailments as such, right from fruits to flowers to leaves, to roots to stems of these Ayurvedic say medicines as such, they have particular seasons, they have particular timings. In fact, she said that if you need to get the perfect balance, you have to pluck those leaves or flowers and fruits during a particular time, and that was the speciality of the best of the Ayurveda acharyas as far as the history of ancient India is concerned. However, now this today has become a business. As a consequence, she said that they literally do it like mining. They just pull out these products and they send it out, and because they market it in such a way, people get fooled away with that. But she certainly said that that's not a fair practice as such. So this is another environmental aspect that one needs to looked into when we are going into the details of agricultural practices as such. This is what, of course, there is a lot to speak about it. You'll see that nowadays you have these hybrid and you have these bioengineering products, etc. You could just go biofertilization is something again, biomagnification is something again that we could go on, but not required in at your level as such. We'll move to the next aspect, that's industry. And as far as industry as an activity is concerned, I'll just clear out this. As far as industry is concerned, what are the major characteristics of industrialization? First and foremost, of course, is mass production. What makes industrialization different to all economic activities before industrialization came into being? So mass production is something that is the major characteristic of an industry. Then you'll see that standardization. Now, what exactly does standardization mean? You'll see that if you compare two professions, one on in an industry and one on skill-based as such. Say, for example, you have a potter who makes pots out of his skill. You'll see that in that case, two pots will not be similar. They would change in dimension somewhat. They eventually would look the same, but they would have different dimensions as such. On the other hand, something made on machines will have those perfect dimensions as such. And in fact, quality control in industry includes checking quality checks of those products, that from product number 1 to product number 100 to product number 1000, the dimensions of the product need to be same. Keeping the dimension of the products to be same is called as standardization. And third aspect is profit maximization. Because a lot of overheads are involved, right from advertisement to payment of salaries, transportation, etc., you see that profit is another aspect about industry as such. Okay, as far as classification of industry is concerned, there are various ways in which industries tend to be classified as such. On the scale based, I would say small scale industry, okay, medium scale, and you have large scale industries also. Then you'll see that on functional basis, I'm just giving you examples, there could be many as such. On functional basis, you could have agro-based, sugarcane is an agro-based industry. You have metallic industries in the sense extracting iron ore or other ores, other metals from their ores as such. Of late, a very popular industry is petrochemical. This is, however, also harming the environment significantly, but then requirement of oil is crude oil, and eventually petrol, fuels like petrol and diesel is such a significant aspect for us that we are helplessly buying that, even though you'll see that petrol has already crossed ₹100 a liter, and diesel should reach ₹100 in some time, unless there is some international event that could bring down these the cost of these commodities as such. So agro-based, metallic, petrochemical, functional, there could be many others. You will see that you have garment, textile industries as such. Now textile meaning synthetic textile as such. Now synthetic textile partially could go into petrochemical and it would go in others also. And you have classification based on ownership, O-W-N-E-R, ownership also. You have private industries, you have public industries, and then you have the joint sector. Okay, then you'll see that there are a few theories on which industrial location is based on. Where do you locate? Of course, we need not go into the basics, but then you have this theory of Weber. Okay, he, on the basis of raw material and the number of raw material and the market and the demand, he has given us models as to where an industry should be located. That's all you need to know. We don't do this in detail as far as FYB 11 is concerned. Weber's theory, I suppose, is done in economics. I'm not very sure about that. Then you'll see that just like in agriculture, of late, particularly in developing countries, you have government policies which are influencing industrial setups to a significant level as such. In Maharashtra, you have special areas which are called as MIDCs, Maharashtra Industrial Development Corporation, wherein they set up these industries and they promote them as such. Okay, and then you'll see that the government is also has the responsibility of checking the pollution out of this, and you have the Maharashtra Pollution Control Board, you have it at the Central Pollution Control Board at the central level also. They're supposed to be working into each other. Then you have what are called as SEZs, special economic zones, wherein you would be providing facilities for special areas as such. And off late, you'll see that one industry which is on a significant boom is the IT industry, okay? Information and technology. Just like, say, agriculture, I would say that in industry also, environment is a major concern. Rather, I would say a larger concern than in industry, than in agriculture. Given the volume as far as of activity is concerned, you will however see that agriculture by volume is larger, but industry by intensity and leading to pollution, the industry could be at any point of time larger as such. So one of the major contributors as far as global warming these days is concerned is the industry and various types of industries put together. In fact, we saw that immediately after the lockdown, over the period of time, we saw a reduction in pollution levels, contamination levels of air, water, and land as such. Okay, so while we study about the industry off late, the in things, okay, that are being spoken about is sustainability of agriculture and industry, and of course environmental concerns that have come up with agriculture and industry as such. Okay, so these were the things that I was supposed to be discussing with you all as a part of your syllabus as such. I know I've not gone into the details of SEZ and MIDCs, which are contemporary issues regarding industries particularly as such. Similarly, a few things like warehousing is something which is not listed in your syllabus, but warehousing is an important aspect with regards to agriculture, particularly refrigeration facilities of cold storage is something that needs to be brought up as far as agriculture is concerned, because agricultural products, particularly high-value agricultural products like fruits, and you'll see that high-value fruits like grapes and cherries particularly are the Indian farmer is lagging basically because there is a lack of storage facilities. The moment we are going to have that, and another aspect that is lagging is penetration. You'll see that you have these facilities, but then in economically prominent areas and so on and so forth, there is no penetration as far as these facilities should be made available in the interior parts as such. Communication linkages are very poor. You see, you may speak about concrete roads, highways, etc., but you'll see that you go a couple of kilometers east and west or north and south of these major national and state highways as such, the roads are very, very poor, and you'll see that majority of the agricultural activities take place during the monsoon, isn't it? Because it's all rain fed. During the monsoons, you'll see that the roads get further, I won't say destroyed as such, but then they you can't call them as roads, because you'll see that on the same road, you'll have the bullock cart on the same road. And of course, it's not a tarred road. And even if it is a tarred road, you'll see that it's not, it does not sustain the weight of a tractor, etc. So you'll have very many ups and downs. And so movement, fast movement along this becomes very difficult, particularly in the monsoon as such. So all these things put together cause a lot of difficulties for the farmer who already has a very small farms as such, and extracting profits out of those small farms could have been possible only if the government and the government policies would help him to cultivate products and maximize his profit as such. But as I said, very small bottlenecks like transportation and warehousing, etc. Marketing, you'll see that nowadays, of course, you'll see that this interesting trend has come up in Pune particularly. You'll see that I see around my house that these small farmers, they have their small tempos, etc. They'll load their it's very similar to market gardening, but not at that scale as such. It's at an individual scale as such. Market gardening is a voluminous scale, I would rather say, but that is also happening. You'll see that nowadays in different localities, you'll find these people come around 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the evening, and they'll park their vehicles, and they'll start selling commodities like products like onions and potatoes and garlics and what else? They'll sell fruits also as such. Okay, now there are two aspects to this. In some cases you can identify these are individual farmers. In some cases you'll identify that there is a certain section which is seen selling, particularly those who are selling fruits as such. Then at a local level, I have seen that the corporator in my area makes arrangements for these things also, in the sense they have what are called as weekly markets as such, wherein the farmers are assured of a weekly market, and the consumers are assured of a weekly display of products as such. It could be very similar to a weekly market in a rural area. It's only that it is funded, officially funded by the local politician, that's the corporator, etc. as such. These are, of course, there could be many other things, but I don't think we need to go into all those details as far as industry and agriculture is concerned. The only thing of concern is in both the sectors, environment pollution is a major cause, and unless and until we address to that particular aspect as such, it is going to be difficult to maintain the standards, because you'll see that as far as agricultural outputs are concerned, the very reason that we are speaking about organic farming is that because of heavy doses of chemical fertilizers, you'll see that major products, agricultural products, have lost their nutritional value as such. And the loss of nutritional value is a cause of concern, basically, because eventually that is going to lead to depriving immunity of individuals as such. And if the immunity drops, we know all what that happens. You'll see that they could be infected with various diseases, and problems could, and comorbidities could arise out of it. Okay, you'll see that problems of diabetes, etc., and is all because of loss of nutritional value of these products as such. So while we think and read and analyze about this, these important things need to be kept into concern. Not only the basic things, but things around them also need to be taken into concern. Yes. That's all as far as your syllabus is concerned. And this, as I said and promised, is going to be your last lecture. A few things about your assignments, I would rather say. I was not happy about majority of the assignments as such. Probably a lot of you all got complacent about marks, and you'll see that you were very, 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 when I said 200 words, that was minimum. Some students have written assignments less than 200 words. That's one thing. And you'll see that others have tried to cut off their write-up the moment they have reached 200 words. As that's something that I would not have liked. People have not thought very seriously about the human geography aspect, I would say, because most of the topics, as the generation goes, I've written it in the WhatsApp message also, is food and clothing, etc. And it's most of it is, you know, I would say it's informative. I had made it very, very clear that it should not be informative as such. It should be innovative. You should think about these things as such. Most of the cases, food and clothing, I would say, make up 40% of the topics as such. Okay, you see that the reason I gave you the slide of Huntington is that it offers you so much variety as such. Unfortunately, that variety was not picked up by majority of the students. And that is why you see that I was not happy with the performance of majority of the students as such. You'll see that majority of the students would be scoring less than what they had, because I realized that giving you, marks on a higher scale last time was my mistake. You have got very, very complacent as such. Many students who have got 18s and 19s in the first semester have scaled down to 14s and 15s in this particular semester as such. I personally do not believe much in marks as such, but I would point at the fact that don't get complacent. You'll see that loss of marks here should be taken as a suggestion that you need to improve the quality of assessment and analysis of any topic that has been given to you as far as assignments are concerned as such. Of course, I have now assessed majority of it, and what remain are basically those who have submitted late as such. So I would again request you all to be very careful about, don't get complacent basically. The fact that you got good marks in the first semester does not guarantee you that you would get the same amount of marks in the second semester, particularly my subject, because the evaluation was based on the quality of the output as such. Okay, now if you have any queries from your side, you could please ask me about those queries. The group obviously is going to be there, and I would be available for